Yeah. All right, we're right at 6:00, so I think to respect everyone's time this evening, we will get started. Just so everyone knows, before we kick things off, we are recording this session so that folks who could not attend this evening or folks who may be participating in multiple working groups can watch the recording. So the recording of this meeting will be posted to the Transportation Working Group subpage on the South Whitehall website. So it will be a resource for our work going forward, but I do just want everyone to know that we are recording this evening. So with that, I want to welcome you all to tonight's very first. You are the first working group to convene for meeting one of the South Whitehall Comprehensive Plan Update. And my name is Hannah Clark. I'm going to be one of your Michael Baker facilitators, working alongside my colleague, Chris Urbasco. And we are obviously working very closely and in coordination with Dave Manhart and Greg Adams from South Whitehall Township. And so before we go around, we do want to do a round of quick introductions. Well, this will be a group that, as you know, will be working together closely over the next few weeks. So I think it's great to get to know who's on the call and really make sure that we're all, you know, ready to go and ready to collaborate. Before we jump into introductions, just one other quick note. We do know that we have folks coming from a variety of areas and a variety of positions in South Whitehall. You might be a resident, you might be a public official, an interested neighbor. And we do want to emphasize that these working sessions are really meant to be the public forum to begin to develop these recommendations. We know that after this round of working groups wrap up, there will be an opportunity for the Planning Commission and the Board of Commissioners to weigh in. And we really are excited that we have so much participation from those entities. But we are very excited that this is a public process where everyone's voice will weigh in and count. So just wanted to emphasize that. And again, you can always feel free to ask any questions throughout the session. Please put it in the chat. And you have our contact information as well. So with that, I would like to do a very quick round of introductions. If you could just say your name and what, you know, brings you here tonight. Are you a resident? Are you a business owner? We'd like you to keep it pretty quick, so 15 seconds, and then we'll go to the next person. So I'm going to go by who's on my screen, and I'll start with Greg Adams.
Hi, Greg Adams, South Whitehall Township's Municipal Planner.
Thanks, Greg. Dave Manhart?
Hello.
Dave, I think you're muted.
I guess it's my turn.
Yes, Al.
Out of practice. I am out of practice. Yes, Dave Manhart, Director of Community Development. We've been working with Michael Baker, and just one note for working groups and Michael Baker's role is, you know, this is kind of the opportunity for the public to make comment. So township staff is kind of taking a step back a little bit. We're here to answer questions or provide any context. But really, you know, Michael Baker, Hannah, and Chris are facilitating the meeting. So hopefully we can get some good engagement. Thank you, everybody, for coming.
And Mr. Tope, we'll go to you.
I'm Al Tope. I'm a member of the Planning Commission.
Thank you. And Mr. McNair.
Hi, I'm Bill McNair, and I'm also a member of the Planning Commission.
Thank you. And Mr. Height?
I'm Brian Height, a member of the Planning Commission and a 51-year resident of South Whitehall Township.
Thank you. Mr. Burke?
Yes, David Burke, resident, citizen resident, Deerfield Springhouse Farms area.
Thank you. Mr. Wilson?
Dave Wilson, I'm on the Township Planning Commission, been a resident of the township for about 11 years now.
Thank you. And Mr. Dravenscott?
Hey, everyone. Mike Dravenscott. I'm actually a resident of Allentown in the West End, but I'm chair of the board of the Delaware and Lehigh National Heritage Corridor and just have a deep interest in interconnecting all our trails.
Thank you. Chris Rabasco?
Hi, Chris Rabasco, planning associate with Michael Baker. I'm assisting Hannah through the project, and I'll be the main facilitator for the Resource Protection and Community Facilities Working Groups.
Thank you. Robert Emanuel?
Hello, everyone. My name is Robert Emanuel. I am a graduate planning student at Temple University and an intern in the Community Development Office for South Whitehall Township.
Thank you. The next person I have, the name says Bender H. Would you like to introduce yourself? If you have audio, can always come back to you.
I'm not sure who you're talking to.
That's her, Bender.
It's her, Bender.
Okay.
Director of Public Works.
Okay. Wonderful. Thank you. Sorry, the Zoom or the, you know, virtual always sometimes puts little funny names. Ms. Kelly.
Hi, I'm Diane Kelly. I am a member of the South Whitehall Township Planning Commission, and I am also a South Whitehall Township Commissioner.
Thank you. Mr. Saviet, sorry for any pronunciation.
So I'm Scott Savette. My wife and I have lived here since 2008. We live over near the Parkland High School.
Thank you so much. And I believe I got everybody. If anyone didn't get to introduce themselves, please unmute yourself and quickly speak up. All right. And if you did not get a chance to introduce yourself and you want to put who you are and where you're coming from in the chat, that works as well. So we have a lot to cover tonight, and as we've said, a lot of this will be very much discussion-based, so we want to get through some of the initial pieces of tonight's meeting, which will start with an introduction to the workbook that you all received, at least a digital copy. Thank you, Mr. Hirsch, and sorry we did not get a chance to hear from you. And so we're going to quickly walk through the workbook resource. As you read in the email correspondence you've received, the workbook is available on the South Whitehall Township website. You can also receive a print copy if you go to the municipal building. You can pick one up. So very quickly, the workbook really is meant to be your roadmap for our working group sessions. As you're aware, we have three topic working group sessions, and then we'll come together at the end for a final concluding meeting where recommendations will be discussed. So we kick things off on June 29th with the intro to the working group meeting, and all those resources again are available on the South Whitehall website. And really that was an opportunity to hear from different folks about some of the framing concepts we're working towards in these working group sessions. So again, the timeline here, this is again taken directly from your workbooks. You can refer to it as much as you would like. We do have, next week will be the meetings with the LVPC subject matter experts, and then we'll be moving into identifying and developing recommendations the week of August 2nd. Today, as you all are aware, we're discussing existing conditions and evaluating where we're at in terms of the planning documents for South Whitehall Township as it relates to transportation. So again, these are the working group resources. These are all listed on the Transportation Working Group subpage. And again, contact information for the staff, obviously, David Manhart and Greg Adams, as well as myself and colleague Chris Rabasco, who are the meeting facilitators. These are the guiding principles that were established at the beginning of the comprehensive plan update process and can be referenced as you go forward and start developing your recommendations. We also wanted just to ground everyone in the guidelines we're following. We're required to follow the municipal planning codes guidelines for a comprehensive plan, and you can refer to it here, what that entails and what that means for South Whitehall. And we did also want to include as a reference, when we had our kickoff meeting for phase four, which happened in March of 2021, we asked people to give us words that they thought of South Whitehall today. And this was the whole township. And these are just some of the words that popped up. So diverse, opportunity, growing, beautiful, all these different ways to think about the community you live in. And then when we discuss the future in the next 10 years, some of the big things that came up were open space trails, so the connectivity piece, opportunity, but also worries about some challenges and potential other areas that we could address as we think about recommendations. And then in June 29th, we had our intro meeting for the working groups, which you may have participated in. And if not, I hope you've been able to visit some of the resources on the website. So the framing concepts that were introduced by South Whitehall Township when it came to growth and future land use, and then the economic development consultant Forward Planning and the transportation consultant Keystone Consulting Engineers provided some thoughts as what could the future look like when we think about growth in South Whitehall, particularly when we think about the surveys that were given out or distributed by the township with where do we grow and how do we grow? And again, these are referenced in your workbook, and you can read the full report on the Phase 4 Comprehensive Plan webpage. The economic development scenario, again, if you were part of that meeting, you heard about the types of development that could be supported and what that can mean for the future growth and land use. And finally, very relevant to this evening's discussion, the transportation model that was presented, we will be able to bring that up to look at it more closely as you continue on this evening and start to think about what is happening with transportation today in South Whitehall. So that brings us to today's meeting. And again, as you read in your workbook, today is really about diving into what are the existing resources and knowledge around data and conditions today in the township. So you'll be hearing from South Whitehall about the 2009 comprehensive plan, what has happened as they began the comprehensive plan update process beginning in 2019, and then where does that take you when you think about the regional context as well. So at this time, I think I'm going to hand it over to Greg Adams to talk you through some of the existing conditions resources that we put in the workbook to ground us in today's discussion.
Good evening, everyone. I do want to start with the MPC guidelines for the transportation portion of the comprehensive plan. Now, this is the Pennsylvania Municipalities Planning Code. It requires a comprehensive plan from the municipality, and it lays down the minimum requirements for that comprehensive plan. Transportation plan is one of those minimum requirements. And if you'll indulge me for a second, I would like to read it to you. A plan for the movement of people and goods, which may include expressways, highways, local street systems, parking facilities, pedestrian and bikeway systems, public transit routes, terminals, airfields, port facilities, railroad facilities, and other similar facilities or uses. That's what this group is going to be studying and making recommendations on over the next few weeks. Next slide, please. Right now, in 2009, the South Whitehall Township adopted the most recent comprehensive plan, the one that is in force today. We'd like to use the 2009 plan as a starting point in this process. We'd like each working group to examine its particular portion of the 2009 comp plan. The data conclusions and goals may still hold relevance today and may spark conversations that will lead to today's conclusions and recommendations. Please note that of the 14 goal statements of the 2009 comp plan, some were fulfilled, some were partially completed, and some have yet to be accomplished. All are useful in considering goals for the working group's recommendation. Remember that all these goals are subject to review by staff and elected officials with regard to priority, timing, funding, and implementation approaches, and are, of course, subject to outside forces. A recession is a really good outside force that has an impact on how the comprehensive plan is moved along. Next slide, please. First one coming from the 2009 comp plan is the current traffic volume. And I think we can all look at this map and see mirrors of what's going on today. I'm sure none of these roads have dropped off in their congestion. I think all of them have increased over time, and we may see some new roads on here that weren't as congested back then that are a little more congested and becoming an issue today. Next slide. This is the roadway classification map from 2009. This is a tool for improving the existing road network. Classifications refer to the township standard in the subdivision land development ordinance. So when land developments occur along a particular roadway, the road will be either constructed or upgraded to those new standards. And this is our best way of improving our road system at this point. Next slide. This is the planned and future transportation infrastructure improvements. This is what we deemed to be the highest priorities in 2009. Now, please note that transportation improvements are very long-term projects, from conception through planning and design to construction. They are also highly dependent upon funding resources. So, particularly PennDOT, especially for PennDOT roads. You will note that most of these improvements proposed have not moved much beyond their conception phase at this point. I think the Route 309 study corridor or corridor study is probably one of the most advanced of these projects at this point. Certainly, we can look at all of these, determine if they're still valid, and keep them as recommendations or add more if you prefer. Next slide. These next two slides are similar. These are the vehicular transportation recommendations from 2009. Once again, some of these we've done well with, particularly closely coordinating with PennDOT and LVPC. Some we haven't moved forward much at all, and some we just haven't started yet. Next slide is the alternative transportation recommendations. Certainly in 2009, these were on our minds. So bicycle and pedestrian transportation and safety, as well as trails, were something that were new to us, but we decided that they were very important. So once again, all of these are to be reviewed and determined if they're still valid and might be included in the future recommendations. Next slide. This is our official map. This was the 2010 official map. This was the first thing we did after adopting the comprehensive plan in 2009. And this is a great tool for municipalities, because what it does is it portrays the infrastructure goals of the township that may be achieved as part of the land development process. It puts property owners on notice that the township has an infrastructure goal associated with the property, and it may be activated if the property owner initiates a land development on that property. We have had some success with this. There's a few projects in there that have come up as part of land developments, and we've achieved what we wanted to do through that. So this is definitely something that's useful, and certainly something that could be expanded for future use. Back in the day, this was a new topic for us and a new tool, and we've learned so much more about it, and certainly hope to use it quite a bit more in the next comprehensive plan. Last slide for me. This is the 2019 existing conditions report. Dave, do you wanna jump in on this, since this was mainly your baby?
I sure can.
Okay.
So this was included in the existing conditions report in 2019 when we first met up at the high school. The first chart kind of just looks at traffic volumes between 2000 and 2018, and we can see a general increase in most of it. Cedar Crest, or wait, that's Hamilton Boulevard, has shown a decrease, but one of the things to be careful about is the traffic data. I know Brian's here and he can probably talk to it a little bit if we want to dig into it. But the general point of it is there's been increases in traffic for the most part. Some more than others. Tillman has really jumped up. Also, we have on their chart is our bridges. So we have 26 state-owned bridges and 5 locally owned bridges. And PennDOT puts standards on bridges. So 16 of those bridges are functionally obsolete, and one is structurally deficient. So that means there's certain criteria that is associated with that, so weight limits and things like that. We have a high crash corridor that was two high crash corridors that was that were introduced in the LVPC plan, Route 22, which is comes as no surprise. And then Cedar Crest Boulevard is another high crash corridor. And then also the congested corridors. So North Cedar Crest Boulevard from Moorfield Road to Parkway Boulevard was identified. Route 22, 309, the 309 at Tillman Interchange. Oh, those are TIP projects. Yeah, so these are projects that were on the TIP. So this is the Transportation Improvement Program, which is works with LVPC and PennDOT. They actually put projects on the TIP, and when once they're on the TIP, the funding is is most likely to come through. There's some changes to that and some tweaks to that, but for the most part, if your project is on the TIP, you're going to see some progress with it. The 309 and Tillman Interchange is currently in design. We've had some initial meetings with engineers looking at engineering issues. 22 widening was also on the TIP, and then the 309 betterment project, which is the project that goes from 22 north to goes into North Whitehall. This is one of the examples of things that are on the TIP that get kind of changed around. The original scope of the project included a lot of widening, turn lanes, and based on funding, it got scaled back to striping. And I think now it's kind of shifting back to some more significant improvements. So that's the existing conditions in 2019.
Great, thank you. And I do, Dave and Greg, if we may, I think we can take a couple minutes if there are any clarifying questions from working group members so far in any of the existing conditions data. And I guess I would just quickly ask if you can put your name in the chat if you want to speak, and we'll just call on you so you don't have multiple folks speaking at once. So you don't need to put your question in the chat, just your name, and we'll call on you. Or any reactions? We're going to have some time to dissect this further when we get into the discussion, but if clarifying questions or anything like that, we can present some of them now.
And one of the things that one of the reasons we went with the workbook, as we're going through the workbook, we have notes sections on it. So if you want to jot something down that you'd like to discuss, that's what it's there for. We did kind of breeze through those pages. So definitely use the notes. I guess, Hannah, there's.
Yep, we have Michael Hirsch has a question or a comment.
Yeah, I was wondering, I heard about the that 309 and Tillman Street Cloverleaf is going to be expanded, and I heard that 7 homes are going to have to be demolished. I just, you know, was concerned that if there's not a better way to do that, that wouldn't, you know, affect those homes so much. I guess that would be south of Tillman Street.
Yeah, I'm not. I don't know exactly which homes were included in that. I kind of recall there's that little strip mall on next to the diner there that they're taking for some of the work.
Is that east of?
That would be west of 309.
What?
So west of 309, I think there's past the diner. Yeah. There's a little building with a few storefronts. I know that's part of it. PennDOT has had public review of the plans, but we will certainly try and dig them up and find the links to them so that sure. we can get a better idea of what's included. And we may, I guess we'll just throw it on the transportation working group for now. But what I'll do is we'll look up and see if we can find PennDOT's link to those plans and then put them up, or at least more information for those.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Wonderful. And Diane Kelly asked, will you be reviewing the details of the 2009 traffic improvements that have been met and those not met? Diane, would you like to expand upon your question at all?
Sure, yes. When Greg was reviewing the 2009 comp plan, he mentioned that there were some that had been met and some not. And I was just wondering if that's something that we will specifically review so that we can learn from what was planned back in 2009 and where we can modify that moving forward into our next plan.
Absolutely. Would you like a quick list now, or do you want to do this more in depth?
Well, that's up to you. I didn't know if it was planned in this presentation, and if not, you can do a quick list right now.
So, Hannah, were we going to, I know there's like, with the workbook, there's sheets that we're going to fill in. Is that where we would do that, or is that something that you want to jump into now?
Well, yeah, what I was going to say is I think this specific question is something where we say we'd like more information. We have that. We'll be kind of looking at all the areas we'd like more information on for as you go into working group meeting two, where you start to think about recommendations and discussing with the Lehigh Valley Planning Commission subject matter experts. So I think if Greg has a very high level response, and then I think one of the tasks coming out of this meeting would be a more detailed look, and we'll make sure to put this on the discussion sheet when we get to that point to ensure that we hit on where more information is requested. Does that sound good?
Yes, I just think it would be good for all members of this group to have the same information as far as the answers to the questions, so yeah.
Of course. And I think the expectation will be any questions where we might be sending follow-up information, all of that will go to all the working group members.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thanks. Greg, did you want to give any quick highlights to the answer to that question?
Yeah. I can do the quick list. I'm looking
to change the slide.
Yeah, if you want to go back to I wasn't thinking so much that one, because really that was specific improvements, and some have come on the TIF, some have come off the TIF. I know we've seen over the past 10 years or so changes in priorities with what PennDOT and LVPC have been putting for funding. So some of those are still on the TIF. I think a good number of them are. Like I said, the 309 betterment project, I think, came out of the corridor study. And I think that's probably one of the best successes at this point. That one was moving forward. It has gotten the funding, and we've gone into design. And we're going to get close to construction phase on some of those projects. We've seen some work done at Ridgeview and 309. Obviously, the Tillman interchange is one of the biggest centerpieces to that. There's a number of projects there that haven't really moved forward yet, and it's all funding based. So if you want to, that's kind of my quick rundown of that one. If you want to go back to the goals, which would have been page 19, you've got 14 there. we did the official map, and that's been a qualified success. Obviously, we are considering mass transit and all site planning. Atlanta gets a plan review for every plan that comes through the door here. We have amended the zoning map to some degree to put traffic and intense uses near the infrastructure that can support them. And we've certainly made an effort to work closely with LVPC and adjacent municipalities on transportation issues. Some of the other things are kind of ongoing. Measuring success is a little hard for that one, but obviously identifying improvements, promoting opportunities for alternative transportation, providing opportunity for neighborhood shopping and convenience and live work units, increasing the number of secondary north, south, east, west roads. That's a difficult long-term project, but we're trying. And the rest of them are kind of stuff that we haven't really gotten off the ground yet. So that's something to consider, that when we go into recommendations, we can look at all of these things and determine, do we want to continue forward with some of these? Do we want to invest a little more capital in moving some forward that haven't been moved forward? Or do we just want to jettison a few of them as no longer relevant?
Thank you.
Thank you, Greg. So I'm gonna, I think we have three more folks. So I'm gonna request that you keep your feedback quick, maybe 30 seconds for your question, and we will see how those get incorporated into the discussion. So Mr. Burke, I believe you had a discussion on one of these items.
Right, yes, I actually had my name there twice, but let me go to the one at 627. And it refers to something Greg just went over on page 19. And that is item 7, amend the township zoning map so that traffic related intensity of permitted uses is appropriate to the capabilities of existing and planned road network. Greg, I think you explained it the opposite of the way I read it here. And I thought the idea is to amend the zoning to match the road capabilities or future road capabilities.
The future road capabilities, yes. You understand that the only way we can get a lot of road improvements done in many ways is simply through land development. The idea of improving a road without a land development is something that's, it's a great idea, but from history shows that it just does not get done. The township really doesn't expend much beyond basic road maintenance. It simply doesn't have the capabilities of widening a road at any one spot. And certainly PennDOT, there are so many projects that PennDOT is tasked to do. That, as I said, some stuff comes on the TIF, some stuff comes off the TIF. Funding has a big impact. Political visibility has a big impact. So basically, if the road network works fine in your neighborhood, that's great. Obviously, we don't need to do much more than maintain it at its current location, at its current spot. But if we've got spots that are definitely congested, really the way to do that is to encourage development and redevelopment on them so that we can get the money and the capabilities to improve those roads. Because otherwise the traffic will come, it will continue to come. And without getting some sort of land development there, the prospect of improving capacity on that road is pretty slim.
Right, and I don't want to take a lot of time here, but it says so that the traffic-related intensity of permitted uses is appropriate to the existing capabilities. That isn't something that's always followed in my mind.
And that's true, yes. And certainly we've tried, and of course we don't have the crystal ball, so we try our best to plan, and planning is not perfect. So in some situations, the planning didn't work out as we anticipated. And obviously, we can all list them, but there are some projects that I think will improve things, at least when looked at as opposed to if they hadn't occurred at all. And I think that's a big feature here. You have to realize the traffic will increase regardless of what we do. And even if we shut down development in this entire township, it will still increase because other townships around us are growing and we will get their traffic. So we have to work with the tools we have at hand. And certainly, whoops, I'm about to get dark here. So certainly, using the tools we have and getting more tools is something we want to strive for. And if certainly we can revisit prior decisions and determine where we went wrong in them, that's great and something certainly we should do.
And this is kind of related, if I could just jump in. That number seven goal is definitely something that has kind of come out of this public outreach, is, and Greg and I have been talking about it internally, is how do we plan for intensity or impacts and intensity, and looking at, you know, as many future impacts as we can. So, you know, this is a goal that to me should probably carry forward. Because it definitely is a good one.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. It sounds, I think we're really revving for a lot of good discussion, so I want to make sure we get to the template. Bill McNair, do you have a quick comment or question? Is it something we can address in our discussion? Sorry, Mr. McNair?
Mute. Yes, I'm sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I just wanted to get an idea of how much we can involve PennDOT in our planning process with our plan, just because you talked about 309 and saying, you know, the good things about it. Well, they've also, that's gone through a lot of different phases where it's been funded and then completely unfunded and going back and forth. And can we, through this process, I don't know, put pressure or ask questions, you know, to get more involved in the TIP process as, say, a coordinated force somehow, yeah, to try to influence PennDOT on things like 309 and others?
I think the vehicle is LVPC, is kind of the chain of command, so to speak, or the process as we go through it, LVPC, to get as much as we can up front. And then, you know, pushing to get involved in as much of the planning process as we can. But again, the TIP, you kind of brought it up, is the TIP fluctuates a lot based on available funding. And, you know, PennDOT manages those projects. And, you know, we can certainly advocate for things, identify projects to move forward through their long-range transportation plan and then to the TIP and then to eventual funding. So that's kind of the process that's set up. But I know, you know, any public meetings that PennDOT has on projects, you know, getting involved as much as we can in those is another avenue.
And certainly identifying projects in the comprehensive plan gives weight to what the township brings to the table.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yep. And certainly the official map, something that we didn't understand earlier, but now we have a better understanding of. So comp plan and official map work hand in hand. So.
Okay.
So, Scott, I know you had a clarifying question about the update to the 2009 traffic map. And I one thing I can quickly add to that is we did receive in our intro meeting some more recent existing conditions analysis from Keystone Consulting Engineers. So if you haven't seen that, it is available. I can put the, we're going to actually navigate to the webpage, but they're very large PDF files. So they were crashing my computer when I put them on here, but I will send where the link is. So that might be a good resource. Does that answer your question, Scott, or do you want to provide us with some additional context?
Nope, that answers my question. Thank you.
Thank you. And David Wilson, you'll be our last to give a quick comment, and then we're going to go into the discussion.
Yes, has the township ever considered an Act 209 study? And if anyone doesn't know what an Act 209 study is, it's basically, well, it's a lot of upfront cost for the township, but then the township can assess traffic impact fees to developers. A lot of municipalities, it's not cost effective for them to do it, but just throwing it out there, if, you know, is that something we've considered? There's a good PennDOT publication out. If anyone wants to take a look at it, I believe it's publication 639 from PennDOT. You could just Google that. It provides some background on that, but you know, that's another thing we can look into it. I know a lot of municipalities, it's not, it's a lot of upfront cost and a lot of municipalities don't do it because of that, but that is a way to get some fees.
Yep. I can just comment quickly. There were a couple of references to it in the goals, setting up traffic, I think it was zones. And that's part of the 209 plan. So it's definitely something to bring up, and a potential recommendation that can come out of this group is to, for the township to move forward with a 209 plan. So thank you for bringing that up, for sure.
I can say, historically speaking, it has been periodically considered, but the township considers itself to have been fairly successful in negotiating with individual developers over time. And that's why we've never actually moved forward with adopting it. And I think that's where we've sat historically. It's been brought up periodically, but Dave, you are correct. The upfront costs are generally cost prohibitive unless you're really interested in getting the job done. And I think because we've been fairly good at negotiations, there just hasn't been that push to get the job done.
Thank you.
Realized I was muted. Sorry. So I think I'm going to move us. I dropped into the chat what we're calling, it's a jam board. And basically, it's a live resource for you to come in. And I'm going to share my screen so you can see it and get acquainted with it. But this jam board has all of our questions that are in the workbook for the discussion template. And what you can do is, as a participant in here, you can click on what's called the sticky note, and you can write your response on the sticky note, save it, and it will post to our Jamboard. And you can do as many as you want to answer these questions. And I will say, this is something that we're really excited about. It's been a very useful tool in past projects, so we hope it works here. If you can't get to the Jamboard, or if you're having issues, you can also navigate to the transportation page, which I'll also drop into the chat. And what we have here is a Google form that you can fill out with your responses. Again, another way to follow along and give your feedback, as well as obviously the discussion we will have. But I wanted to share those two resources. We do encourage you to use the Jamboard if that works for you. And we'll also obviously be, you know, asking folks for their feedback and to speak up. So I don't know if anyone wants to kick it off with the Jamboard, but our discussion is really what information do we need? What information or data is significant? So Diane, I think your question about what has been accomplished and what's still on the table could come in here if you want to add that in again, so we keep it in our sights and get that more detailed information. So please, and if you are having trouble with the Jamboard, please put any questions into the chat. If there's another way, you can also feel free to, if your comments, if the Jamboard isn't working for you, you can feel free to put your comments in the chat or access that Google form. So I think we'll give folks a couple minutes here to give, put up some feedback, write your thoughts on what information or data that you've heard about in this existing condition report is useful, what it feels significant to carry forward as we evaluate recommendations for the comprehensive plan update.
So just a note, I'm seeing congested corridors and TIP projects. I'm actually taking notes of links I should put on the working group page. So the LVPC and PennDOT have a, I'm pretty sure it might be PennDOT's, have a very good TIP viewer. So I'll post a link to that. I will also post a link to congested corridors information from the LVPC. The link to that application 639 for the 209 plan. And then also there's additional information from PennDOT on traffic data. Some of it's pretty rich, to say the least. It's traffic engineering, so the information's in there, but I'll at least post a link to that as well.
Great. Thank you, Dave. And yes, one of the benefits of using this Jamboard or having it so we can all see it is we'll also be able to download this and have these as a resource so you can capture all the feedback that we're getting live in this meeting. And then let's say you think of something else and you want to add it via the Google form, that's another tool for you as well. Or if someone couldn't attend, they can use the Google form to add their thoughts in addition to what is up here on the Jamboard. So it might take a little getting used to, but I am getting these requests for annotations, and I have to tell you, I'm not 100% sure what that means. If you are looking just to post something, all you need to do is hit the sticky note, and that will allow you to add any thoughts, and you can add again as many as you would like. So I think just because we have a good amount of discussion and questions to get through, let's see where we're at with the information. So Dave already said we'll be collecting information on the status of TIP, congested corridors. We have some, looks like, information around anticipated growth, some questions about trails and connectivity, planned and completed sections of the Jordan Creek Greenway specifically. So something else you can do if you'd like, if you agree with anything that's up here and you want to very quickly add a check mark to show that you like what someone has said, you can put a check mark next to one of the comments. So at this time, I think if there's any additional thoughts or questions on what's up here, that if anyone would like to speak up or share their feedback, we could also take that if you want to put either just speak up, or you can put your name in the chat. And I know
Wilson, I'll just say congested corridors. I'll put a check mark next to it.
Okay, awesome. Thank you. And I do know, Dave, and this is probably something to carry forward when we meet with LVPC next week with this group, is the existing sidewalks and gaps is another data set we know LVPC manages for the region and is something that could be very helpful. So in addition to getting these questions here, I think Dave and Greg, we can ask LVPC to focus some of what they'll be talking about around some of the data sets that they have.
So just a quick comment with the sidewalks and gaps. We have the LVPC, well, actually when I was at the LVPC, I did the sidewalk inventory for the valley, but it only identified road sections. I've since taken that information and digitized all the sidewalks in South Whitehall. So they are in as a GIS layer. And also we've looked at digitizing the, we went through historical deferrals and put in sidewalks that were deferred as part of the planning process. So they're also shown on the map. We do have to go back in and update some of the more recent deferrals aren't in there. That information is, I suppose, we'll talk about releasing it and putting it up on the working group page.
Great. Any other final thoughts before we move to the next question? So with that, and these questions are related, so some of these might go quicker than others, but in terms of starting to develop, why is something significant enough that it could affect the recommendations you are going to start to develop as a working group? So if you want to expand on why are existing gaps in the sidewalk network important, you can give us some of your additional thoughts here. Or why do you want to know specifically about the Jordan Creek Greenway? Is it about connectivity between municipalities or larger recreation opportunities? So if you just would take a minute or two and maybe add some of your thoughts as to why what you prioritize as significant, what it means as we move this forward in identifying recommendations. If you want to throw it up on the Jamboard here, or feel free to drop it into the chat if that's easier. And if you'd prefer to just speak up and give us your thoughts, you can do that as well. Just either start to speak or put your name in the chat and we'll, you know, just make sure no one's speaking on top of each other. So the concept of continuing to play catch up, so being reactive versus proactive, sounds like something that's here. When we're thinking about, you know, again, what are the volumes that correspond with high crash corridors? And again, what ways can these be addressed through maybe mitigation measures? Mr. Hirsch said, I think it's significant for students to be able to walk to school in some instances and not rely on buses so much. So if Mr. Hirsch, that's all right, I'm just going to quickly add that.
Sure, I couldn't figure out how to get back to this, that significant.
Okay, and I'll reshare the, did other people have that issue?
I had the same issue. You got to switch the slide on the top.
Yeah.
I almost wrote a note on the old one.
Where is the sticky note icon?
Sticky note is right here. If you see me sharing my screen, it's the one right in the middle.
The fourth one down.
The fourth one down is.
There's something, the annotation's covering it or something's covering it on my screen.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
But it's the, fourth one down with the box.
And the fourth one down for me isn't that.
Oh, it's not the sticky note?
No.
And you definitely go to the link on your own browser and add things in. But if you, and again, if it's not working for you, put it in the chat and we'll add it up to the Jamboard. So we're hearing some more about Jordan Creek as a multimodal corridor, thinking about reduced commuter traffic and what that could mean, especially with our new hybrid work situations. Does anyone want to, before we jump to the next one, does anyone else want to expand upon or drop in any other thoughts, either on the Jamboard or in the chat, or speaking up about why certain data is significant. Yes, go ahead.
This is David Wilson. Yes, I would say investigating if doing an Act 209 study is economically feasible is significant, because if the impact fees we can assess to developers far outweighs the upfront cost to do the study, then it may be a good thing to pursue.
And Mr. Wilson, you'll just, I put in your thoughts generally, but you can feel free to edit it.
Thank you.
Great, and identified areas of concern. So it does seem like layering in, understanding where there are these touch points, and I think that's gonna get us to our next question for folks. And I hope you don't mind going, this is in lieu of us writing on post-its and putting them up around the room. So this is what we're meant to embody, but where in the township are these concerns significant? Where should, you know, we saw the map that Greg presented from the 2009 plan and where there were hubs of activity. Where are some places either you want to emphasize that are already highlighted, new places? We know we've seen a lot of increases in congestion. We've seen some corridors become more significant in terms of crashes and other issues. Or also, on the other hand, where are those big multimodal opportunities like the Jordan Creek Greenway or others? So this one, if you want to drop in locations or places that are important to start to direct some of these recommendations. And just remember, if you are having trouble navigating, you go to the top of your Jamboard and there's next frame, and that will take you, if you're still on number two, it will take you to number three. And if you're tired of writing on stickies, you can just shout it out and I'll write it for you. We have Route 22 Cedar Crest. Someone about to say something?
No. Two things.
309 in Ridgeview.
Yeah.
All right. Orfield Road at Cedar Crest, especially afternoon rush hour, higher classification roads. And if anyone wants to add to the comments they're putting on here, please feel free to speak up. So the importance of a trail network that's beyond recreation, that's definitely something communicated in some of the 2009 goals, I would say, Greg, and how that gets advanced. And I think just a question, maybe just, and this is some of the sidewalks in neighborhoods. So that was to my question, are there some areas where sidewalks are a really big issue? I, you know, living in this area, I know for me, not seeing sidewalks in Hamilton Boulevard can always seem, makes me get a little nervous as I see folks coming from work at Dorney Park. But yeah, we're seeing, there's a lot of good suggestions here. Anything else anyone would like to expand upon or drop in the chat? Any reactions, Greg or Dave, in terms of what's being put up here?
I'm just putting in the Hamilton Dorney Park pedestrian issue. So that is a big issue.
I'm just wondering, back in 2009, we looked at the Mock Chunk Corridor. And that was a group of planned intersection improvements. I'm just wondering if that's still a high priority, or are there others? Does what's on the Jamboard represent definitely higher priorities than the Mock Chunk Corridor? I know priorities change over time, so what seemed to be important back in the day may not be nearly as much.
Yeah, and just another thing. One thing with this exercise and just these planning exercises in general, you know, it's what we're reacting to at the moment. There may be things that pop in your head later that you say, oh, I should have put this in there or something. That's why we have that Google form. And Hannah can kind of go over that piece of it. So that if you, and also having a workbook where you can take notes, so that when we reconvene or you go to that Google form, you have an opportunity to put things in. Because a lot of times it is difficult to get all your thoughts in an exercise like this. So this hybrid approach will help with that. So we get the initial, and then, you know, after you have time to think about it, we'll have that reaction as well.
Definitely. And the good thing about the Google Forms is you can submit as many times as you want. So if a thing, something comes up for in the geographic recommendations, then later on you think of something else in response to another question, you can just keep submitting it. So we'll revisit that before we close out, definitely, to make sure everyone knows where it is and what it looks like. So is there any other comments that anyone else in the working group has about what's up here or anything else you'd like to drop in?
Nice.
Yeah, there's a lot of good ideas. So I'm going to move us to the next question if that works. And I think the purpose of this question, again, thinking about how these build on one another, is not, do you disagree with anything from the previous question? So if you would like to bring up maybe concerns, you can feel free. But I would say, when you think about what was presented during the existing conditions portion and what you heard, do you feel like it aligns with where the township is heading based on the data that you have and what the recommendations were saying? Or is there, you know, a different direction that should be considered, or maybe some ways of thinking about things that could be alternatively addressed? So this is an opportunity, I think, to think more generally about what we're considering in these existing conditions, and if there's, you know, something that you may not disagree with, or you may not agree with, or that you might want to challenge as we move forward. So to introduce some healthy debate into our working group. And if there's something more specific that you've heard about and you want to provide a different viewpoint, that also feel free to drop that in here, respectfully, of course. I don't know, Dave or Greg, do you disagree with anything from 2009? Think about how we assess transportation data. And that's open to anyone, please.
Just a general comment. Part of the difficulty with planning is getting the information in a usable format. So part of that, the looking at traffic impacts and on the existing network and where they may come, it combining the existing data into the planning and zoning data is a bit of a challenge. So getting over that hump, you know, as data becomes more useful and GIS technology becomes better and better, a lot of that capability becomes available to us. So we're certainly getting close, and, you know, we will hopefully be able to dig into it a lot more once we get either with this working group or into the planning commission portion of the transportation element, for lack of a better term.
I just tried to summarize it in a way that may not be
No, that's actually really good. Thank you.
Anyone else? I know this one's a little harder to probably write on a Jamboard. So if anyone wants to speak up and just share their thoughts, please feel free. And always, again, like Dave said, you can always revisit this in the Google form if something comes up or you want to expand upon something. Great. Seems if we also have an So one of the comments that came in a few minutes ago, the comp plan should be continually updated, thinking about how rapidly things change and if 10 years is, you know, really the right time frame for reassessing everything. We also have someone saying that little we spend on trails as when compared to how much we spend on roads. And if either of you who provided those comments want to expand upon it, please feel free.
I can kind of, with regards to the 10-year, we've been kind of discussing that and thinking about it. We don't have to, we can put mechanisms in place or make recommendations to put mechanisms in place where we evaluate the comprehensive plan every 5 years or 3 years or two, you know, whatever the recommendation is and whatever the planning commission decides, to have that interim step. And then, you know, that would also help with identifying what needs to change in the future comp plan. So it's definitely worth looking at more frequently and identifying issues that are coming up as they appear, as opposed to reacting to them every 10 years. I think that's something we should definitely put in there.
Yeah, and especially when we think about transportation impacts and development, and like you guys said, how even if it's not happening within the township borders, it can definitely be affecting you. Other thoughts or anything anyone else wants to add before we move on? All right. So our next question is if anything is surprising here and what we're unpacking. And again, this really the purpose of these questions is to start to think about what's really resonating, what's rising to the top, and what we might need to know more about. So, if you don't feel like writing it in a post-it, feel free to just speak up and we'll capture it for you. So anything surprising in what has been discussed so far or in the data that's been presented?
I mean, I'll write it up, but one of the things that maybe was a little surprising is how much of an impact on Cedar Crest the development scenarios had in Scott's model. I knew it was going to be bad. I didn't know it was going to be that bad.
And yeah, what Dave's referring to is the model that was presented on our June 29th intro working group meeting, which is available. I dropped it into the chat a few links above. But I don't know, Dave, if you want to expand upon what the model considered at all that was surprising.
So the traffic model, we had a traffic model and an economic model conducted on these scenarios that were developed as part of the where should we grow and how should we grow. And he evaluated potential traffic from those potential developments and indicated levels of service along some of the major corridors. And Cedar Crest was basically all H's, which I like to say stands for help. All H's along basically between Walbert and Dillman. So there's a lot of big concerns with Cedar Crest.
Yeah. No, that's a piece of information, that model, that you just want to spend some time zooming in. So we're also hearing from folks about the amount of 2009 recommendations not completed or even acknowledged. So thinking about implementation and how that's tracked, or at least I interpret it that way. Please definitely feel free to speak up and add context. The other comment about how little South Whitehall Township invests in some of these infrastructure improvements that we're discussing. And I think this is great how much PennDOT controls our road infrastructure. I think Dave, you and Greg, you were both explaining that very clearly. So I don't know if either of the authors of those comments want to expand on what you've said or add anything to it, or if others are prompted to add their thoughts.
I would just kind of piggyback on the previous slide. We had the posted about the evaluating the plan more than every 10 years. That kind of gets to looking at the goals from the 2009 plan. If we had a process in place where we were looking at it, you know, and looking at specific goals every 2 years, we'd have a better idea of how they're working out. Another common practice in planning is with the recommendations is making near term, you know, medium term and long term goals. So that's another way to kind of prioritize and look at things with relation to time horizons, you know, and that allows, when you're looking at the comp plan, to look at it and say, all right, here's a near-term goal. We need to get on this, as opposed to long-term goals, you know, will typically carry over into the next comp plan. So prioritizing goals is something that should be done. I would certainly recommend doing that. So yeah, and that, you know, that's more than just the transportation piece of it. Definitely goes on into the whole comp plan process.
Indeed. I'd like to make a little note here. Much like transportation is long-term and expensive, planning for all this stuff is also long-term and expensive. You need a robust planning staff to accomplish this. Obviously, you know, something that we, all COVID aside, something that we as a planning staff started 2 years ago, more than 2 years ago now. You know, we're down one member of our planning staff from then, and it's just been a heavy lift for us. And you know, we thank Michael Baker for coming on, but there is an expense for that as well.
And Robert.
And I'll throw in Rob Roy, because he's doing some stellar work out there as well. It takes money and time and personnel.
And one of the other, just to piggyback a little bit, you know, there's definitely low hanging fruit out there, and identifying that as part of the plan. Typically low hanging fruit is near term goals that hopefully won't take a lot of work and can get done quickly. So in addition to identifying, you know, time horizon, you can also identify funding, potential funding sources, and that helps with staffing decisions and moving forward with specific items.
And I think just to set the table for where we're headed over the next few weeks, you know, we if you page to meeting three of your workbook, you'll see these recommendation templates. And I think being very intentional, like how we're being, what we're kind of sifting through in this initial what's out there, what are we seeing, to how do we prioritize and build out recommendations that will get done, or we have a roadmap for getting it done, is definitely, I would say, a goal of this process and how we built out the workbook. And please, Dave or Greg and anyone, again, this is very much a conversation. I'm going to move us to, I believe it's the final question. And this, again, is just quick fire, and you can add other things again. But what's missing? I think, what are some opportunities for us to think about new, you know, sources of data? Exactly. What's not on the table? So think about it as data, think about it as what resources. but no, that this just throw them up there, and they are, drop them in the chat, and we'll throw them up or speak up. We have a lot of options. But I think with transportation, that one is painfully obvious. Funding is big challenge, especially with PennDOT situation.
And certainly, you know, this is something that not many people think about, is how hamstrung municipalities are by the state. Obviously, either you have an Act 209 or you don't, and Act 209 is expensive, but we don't have any options of, you know, outside of an Act 209, of requiring offsite improvements for, you know, projects along local roads. You know, we're limited to the taxing and funding capabilities that the state grants, you know, municipalities. So, you know, in a lot of ways, it would be nice if the state were more municipality friendly, to allow us to do a little more of our transportation planning, and to be able to fund it, and to the power to control it.
And I think that's one of the important things to hopefully come out of this working group and the comp plan, is identifying projects that help. There was mention, I think it was one of the goals was a capital improvement plan. So a capital transportation improvement plan, to give the decision makers the kind of, I love what you said, out of the roadmap forward, to look, and maybe because we're in the transportation working group, it resonates. But identifying these projects and, you know, goals that, and this is the whole point of a comp plan, is to identify projects and goals and things that the township, the municipality, the residents want to do, and help inform decision makers on where to direct money and funds to get some of this stuff done. So that's really the end game with this whole process. And having these discussions at this point is terrific. And yeah, great.
Yeah, no, this is all these are the foundational pieces that will really propel us into the next few meetings, where the rubber is going to hit the road, and we're going to need to build out what these recommendations are for this comp plan. Is there anyone on the line who wants to just add your thoughts, or in terms of what's missing or where we can head with this work?
Yeah, this is Dave Wilson. All I'd like to say is, you know, my key item I'd like to emphasize is how do we get that money to, you know, upgrade the roads? Like it was mentioned, road construction is extremely expensive, and, you know, any municipality doesn't really have the money to make all these road upgrades. So it's nice to have all this information and say we need upgrades here and there, but what's going to happen at the end of the day? Does it just sit on the shelf like the 2009 stuff and none of it gets done? I think we really need to focus on how do we get the money to implement any of these recommendations. And you know, at the end of the day, as bad as it sounds, it's typically the developers that build the roads. You know, they have the money, so any way we could get more money from the developers to help build the roads, I think is a good option.
Yeah, and that's there were a couple of things that just as a reaction, the if a project's identified, particularly on the official map, that opens the negotiations with the developer. So again, going back to having these projects identified and where best to put them, what tool to use to get them funded and or discussed during the land development process is important. One comment with regard to, you know, funding and infrastructure. So, you know, we're working on a road master plan. So a maintenance plan, so basically repaving. Herb's on the line, but his mic's not working. And the idea is if we can identify the paving projects, then also supplement that with some of the other transportation projects that are identified as part of the comp plan. Again, it helps the decision makers make the decisions on what to fund and how to prioritize and what the recommendations are. So again, it's all information that eventually gets funneled to decision makers on funding. You know, whether it's, you know, internal money or, you know, we're pursuing grant money. Having projects in a comprehensive plan is a big deal for funding.
Very true. And I think with that comment, Dave, you're leading us to, if we want to just capture some of the key takeaways, and this is something that as facilitators, we will also distill from today's discussion and share out, but if anyone wants to put in,
Money.
Definitely the context around that is incredibly important. Some of the things, this is just what I've been hearing, and please everyone jump in or shout out and I'll write it.
I have a question.
Yes, please go ahead.
This is Lynn. Now I missed the beginning of this, so I don't know if this was covered or not, but what, because I know there's also a housing working group. So what happens in the end if the recommendations that we're working on and what we're concluding end up clashing with what housing comes up with, or will those two groups be meeting periodically to work out what each one's coming up with?
So that's an excellent question. And what's happening is the recommendations from each individual working group will get funneled to the Planning Commission. And the Planning Commission, through comp plan workshops, will be identifying any conflicts or if there's anything, you know, like you said, if housing makes a recommendation that doesn't jive with the transportation recommendation, the Planning Commission will hopefully figure out a way to remedy that or mitigate one or frankly prioritize one over the other if it comes to that. So, you know, it was somewhat intentional to have the working groups focus on their individual topic area so that they can prioritize what's important to that topic area. And then everything gets put to get packaged in our final meeting and handed over to the Planning Commission to make the hard decisions.
That's why they're paid the big bucks. And certainly, just so everyone knows, the Planning Commission meetings will be public. So you can certainly go there and join in the conversation there as well.
Yes, and I think that these are some really sessions to get deep into what the Planning Commission will be considering, and these work, you know, will create a master workbook, is I think how we've envisioned it, with all the work of each working group that will get ultimately handed off, but they're not just handed off and who knows where they'll go, they'll be the basis for how this comp plan comes together. So I know we're closing in on the end of our meeting, and I really do appreciate everyone sticking with us. I know we're fully in nighttime. Does anyone have other key takeaways that have?
Yeah,
yes, go ahead.
A takeaway. In a sense, we're reactionary to the developers in terms of what they want to build, when they're going to do it, and where they're going to do it. And we're just responding. We don't have a lot of control over this stuff. That's the way I read it.
Well, we do, in as much as we can control the zoning. So we can limit.
Yeah, but we only do that once every 10 years.
Well, we can do it whenever. You can amend the zoning map at any time. So that becomes a political will sort of thing.
But that doesn't happen.
Well, like I said, political will.
That's all, you know, that's pie in the sky.
Yeah.
We're just reacting to everything. That's the problem. We don't have a control over when it happens, where it happens, or what's going to happen. We've seen that at Ridge Farms. We're looking at it now at another place, and that's the sad reality. While we say we can control the zoning, nobody has the guts to stand up to it and face the lawsuit.
Well, and just a couple comments. The comp plan forms the basis for the zoning. So if there's things that come out of here that make recommendations for the changes to the zoning, it certainly helps.
Sure.
With any lawsuit. Mm-hmm. So it's part of the process with
right.
that regard. And, you know, the whole idea of identifying projects, you know, is hopefully we're not reacting to things. We're putting stuff down so that we, with an intent of potential developments. And, you know, the other takeaway out of your comment is to look at the comp plan more
right. That's the key.
Yeah. You mentioned the when development happens, and that's right. Economics. You know, when the economy's good, the development's going to happen.
Right. Right. So,
you know, that's why looking at the comp plan and figuring out that mechanism on how we do that, whether it's a report or something, is very important. More frequently.
Yep.
Definitely a key takeaway there.
So anything else anyone wants to add as we close things out? I'm just going to refer folks again to the Google form and also I would love to hear if anyone wants to drop their thoughts on this Jamboard format, because it's something like I said, as we were jumping into it, we wanted to try it out to see if it kind of replicated that, you know, collaborative environment of throwing up thoughts on a board with sticky notes. So if you can drop your thoughts about it in the chat, you can obviously send them to us, or you can share them now. Because this is just an interesting tool, especially in the virtual space. But to take us, so the transportation subpage for the working group, this is where the recording of this meeting will be located. It's where the Jamboard report will be provided and all the resources. So you'll be able, you know, if you want to refer back to the workbook, that's linked here. And then this is what the Google form that we're talking about. So those 6 discussion questions that we utilize to move our conversation forward tonight, can be filled out on this Google form. And again, you can think of something and you want to throw it in there, just feel free. You can submit as many times as you want. We're also using it for folks who maybe couldn't attend. So if you know someone who's interested in this topic and couldn't make it tonight, they can watch the recording or just page through the workbook and answer these questions so we capture their input. Just another tool, again, is to really gather and source all this input during the working group process. So with that, are there any final questions or thoughts? And Dave or Greg, I want to give you the opportunity to say anything on behalf of the township and then obviously open it up to our working group members.
I would say thank you for participating and taking time.
Definitely.
You know, one of the things we've heard, and, you know, if the virtual platform, one of the things we've seen is I feel like we've had better engagement through the virtual platform, particularly with the comp plan. So any tool that we can use to mimic, you know, an in-person meeting, so the sticky notes, I think has been pretty great. You know, and also having the recordings and people can watch and then fill out the forms, the same form, basically the same questions we're working through tonight, is another valuable piece to get as much input as we can. So thank you, everyone.
It's a huge thank you, and a reminder that we will reconvene with subject matter experts from Lehigh Valley Planning Commission. I believe we will have Becky Bradley, their new director of transportation, and I think one other member of the Planning Commission available to talk through how recommendations start to be identified and developed, and bring in some of, again, like we were talking about, some of those data points that hopefully they can also expand upon and give us some good insights in that space. So that will be next Tuesday. It will also be virtual. The meeting link will be sent out soon, and that will be from 6 to 7:30 p.m. on Tuesday the 20th. But you have my contact information if you have any comments about or questions about the format or the workbook itself. And obviously you have the ability to contact Dave Manhart and Greg Adams from South Whitehall. We really appreciate you. So thank you guys so much. If you have any final thoughts, please drop them in the chat. And we look forward to seeing you next week, or again this week if you're in another working group. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right now.
Good everyone.
Good night. All right, just wanted to check where Taylor went.
Kick anybody out.
I know, Dave, you've had an epic day of driving and